Hi guys, good morning. How are you doing? Hope you had breakfast and all that. So let us begin, buddies, shall we? Right, so today we have to continue our discussion. Guys, one small clarification from my side. I was just doing little bit of proofreading also yesterday. As in when we are doing, I'm checking everything. But yesterday I missed out 2 points. There is a typographical error, or rather error in this chart book, very small error. I'll just let you know now. First one, check it out. In CL 21, see, yesterday we were discussing this prospectus, right? In that we were also discussing the concept of private placement, okay? So in the private placement here, this part, a company making an offer shall allot its securities within 60 days, correct? And then what happens? You have to refund within 15 days. And on the completion of 60 days, within 15 days from the completion of 60 days, then interest is charged at 12% per annum on the expiry of 16th day. Is that, sorry guys, it is 60th day. So this was actually an amendment also which came in 2018. So it's not 16 day or 75th day. Yesterday that confusion was there. Sorry. So this make the change. It is 60th day. So basically, you should refund within 15 days from the completion of 60 days. Okay. So after the completion of 60 days, you have 15 days for refund. If you don't do the refund, whatever the case may be, interest will be charged from the 60th day on expiry of the 60th day, means from the 61st day onwards. 61st day onwards, interest will be charged. That is issue number one. So in the yesterday's discussion, whatever in the chapter 3 discussion, you please make this change in the chapter 3 discussion. Make this change. One more change in the chapter 3 private placement would be same in private placement concept only. It's a change in chapter number 3. One more is what, guys? Here, penalty. This also has been slightly amended. There's an error here. One is what? If you contravene the section, amount involved in the offer or 2 crore. Earlier it was whichever is higher, like before, I'm talking about 1956 and all those things. Now they said ease of doing business and also decriminalization. They said don't make it higher, let's make it whichever is lower. Because what used to happen was, as I told you yesterday, I told you whichever is higher, so that there what used to happen was, you know, even if it was like 10 lakh, 20 lakh, but the amount involved was 10 lakh, 20 lakh, but if I take 2 crore, whichever is higher, it would obviously be a little unfair. Same change is also there in, you know, your SEBI guidelines with respect to insider trading in CA final and all those things. There also the minimum amount was, you know, 25 crore. But what if my fraud was only 10 lakh? Should I pay 25 crore was the idea. So there and here they have changed here. It is whichever is lower. So, sorry about this. In the chapter 3, those two changes. So we have read this entire chart book, each and every line, but here and there sometimes mistakes crop up. Don't worry, that's why I am here. I am making those changes. Till now, whatever we have discussed, only 2 changes, guys, and that too, both the changes only in private placement. One is it should be whichever is lower, that is some relief to the person who commits the, you know, mistake. And also here it is 60 days, 15 days, whatever, and the interest will be 12% on the expiry of the 60th day, that is from the 61st day onwards. These are the 2 changes that I wanted to tell you. All right. Cheers. Now, so now, buddies, let's move on to the other areas, shall we? So yesterday we have finished 4 chapters. Yesterday we have successfully finished 4 chapters. And today we have to see the next chapter, 5, 6 and 7. Those chapters going on, we can see. So let's get on with chapter number 5, acceptance of deposits. Chapter number 5, acceptance of deposits. Deposits is given from section 73 to 76 capital A. Alright, so what is a deposit? It includes any receipt of money by a company by way of deposit or loan or any other form. Deposit or loan or any other form. So the question here is loan also a deposit? Is loan also a deposit? Is the question. So the thing is, there are exceptions to this. This deposit rules will not apply to banking company, non-banking finance company and housing finance company. It will not apply to banking company, non-NBFC, non-banking finance company and HFC, housing finance company. Apart from that, it will apply to all other companies. Now, it says includes any receipt of money by way of deposit or loan or any other form or loan. Now tell me, if I go to a bank and take a loan from the bank, correct? Is that also a deposit is the question. So ideally, as per the definition, it is yes. But then we need to see as to what is deposit, what is not deposit, etc. Because for this, there are certain rules. So I need to understand the rules of the deposit to know what is included, what is not included. As far as the deposits are concerned, which are the companies which can accept deposits, friends? That is an eligible company. What is right. Hope you are able to see, buddies, all of you. All good. Let's continue. Right. Great. Chalo, let's start. So I again will repeat quickly. One is what? Deposit. Deposit includes any receipt of money by a company by way of deposit or loan or any other form. What are the exceptions? Exceptions are banking company, non-banking finance company or a housing finance company. These three things are covered. Non-banking company, banking company and housing finance company. And what is eligible company? Means a company where the net worth is not less than 100 crore or turnover is not less than 500 crore. Now moving on. These are not considered to be deposits as per the rules. So as I told you, any amount received from a foreign government, international bank is not a deposit. Amount received from central government, state government or any local authority is not a deposit. Then loan from a banking company. See, I told you, sir, what about all loans? Is it a deposit? They have clearly mentioned that loan from a banking company is not a deposit. Loans from a banking company is not a deposit. Then loan from a PFI, public financial institution, will not be a deposit. Amount received against issue of commercial papers, amount received from any other company, intercorporate deposits. Intercorporate deposits are not deposits. Intercorporate deposits are not deposits. Amount received against issue of securities, amount received from present director, mind you, amount received from a present director. So today I am a director of the company, I give some money to the company, that will not be treated as a deposit. Also amount received by issue of bonds or debentures, which is having a pari passu clause, will not be deposit. So basically, intercorporate debentures are also not deposits. Intercorporate debentures are also not deposits. Amount received from an employee not exceeding his annual salary. interest-free deposit received from an employee. Generally, some companies, what they used to do, they used to, when you become an employee, no, you have to sign a bond and give some money to the company. Infosys, etc. used to do this, because what people used to do, in Infosys, no, there is rigorous training. 6 months, 7 months training in the Mysore campus. So you join the company, I will invest so much on you and I'll train you for 6 months, then 7th month you will escape and run away. So there used to be like a 2-year bond where he has to stay mandatory for 2 years, 6 months training, 1.5 years he has to work. He has to furnish a bond to the company and also give some, you know, refundable deposit amount. That would have been some 1 month salary or something he has to deposit with the company to ensure that he does not leave, because 6 months will be your training. And after 6 month training, if you just run away like that, what is the point? The company has invested so much money in you, right? Money, time, forget about money, time. And we already always know time is money. So those are the things that we need to keep in mind, right? So coming to this, if I take a bond like that and if I take some money from the, what do you say, employee. So what does he saying? Amount received from employee not exceeding what? His annual salary. Not exceeding his annual salary. Interest free. So 1 month, 2 months, etc. like that you can take deposit, but it should never ever increase your, go beyond what? Your annual salary. Should not go beyond your annual salary. So those are the things that we need to keep in mind. Right, next. Next, guys. Then what should you do? Who is a depositor? Means any member or any person who had made a deposit with the public company under section 76. So only certain companies can take deposits, public company under section 76. So those companies you can go with the deposit. And who is a depositor? Any member of the company or any person who has made the deposit as such. Prior consent of the company in the general meeting has to be taken by means of a special resolution. By means of a special resolution, you should take the, what do you say, if you want to apply for a deposit, etc., whatever it is, you should take a special resolution if a company has to accept deposits. ROC plus RBI approval also required wherever needed. And an eligible company which is accepting deposits under section 181C may accept deposits by passing of an ordinary resolution. So this eligible company is there, no? This company, see, eligible company. There is a thing, when I am accepting funds, right, it's called borrowing money. Borrowing money, guys, is given in section 179(3)(d). Under 179(3)(d), to borrow money, I should borrow under by passing a board meeting resolution. By passing a board meeting resolution. Along with the board meeting resolution, I should also, it can be also delegated to a managing director and all those things. Managing director, whole time director, it can be delegated. That is one. Second, if I am borrowing up to net worth, then I can go under 179(3)(d). But if I am borrowing beyond the net worth, I have to go to one more section, and that section is 181C. Under 181C, if I am borrowing money beyond the net worth of the company, what is net worth? Paid up share capital plus free reserves plus security premium account. If the shareholder, this is also called as shareholders funds. If the shareholders funds are, let's say, 20 crore. Now my borrowing, whatever I am doing now, along with already whatever I have borrowed put together, is going beyond 20 CR. It's coming to 23 CR. If it's coming to 23 CR, what do? I need to go to 181C. 181C, what resolution is needed? Board meeting resolution plus special resolution. Now, obviously, when I am accepting deposits, it's obviously like borrowing. I'm accepting deposit means it's like borrowing only. So they are saying for all companies you have to pass special resolution. But if you are eligible company, dear friends, if you are an eligible company, for you, what resolution is needed? For an eligible company, they say you need a ordinary resolution. Sir, what is eligible company? This one, where a company whose net worth is not less than 100 CR or turnover is not less than 500 crore. So for them, accepting deposits, may accept deposits by passing an ordinary resolution. So for them, guys, it is what resolution? It is an ordinary resolution. Very, very simple. Moving on. Non-applicability, this, all these deposit clauses will not apply to a private company which accepts from its members monies not exceeding 100% of PUC and reserves. So this, all these clauses that we are discussing will not apply to a private company if they accept deposits from its members. Mind you, private company cannot issue deposits to the public, but they can issue deposits to their own members. Members, what is the maximum limit? 100% of PUC and FR. 100% of PUC plus FR. 100% of paid up capital and free reserves. Up to 100% of paid up capital and free reserves, I can accept from the members. Beyond that, I cannot accept. Then if I want to accept beyond that, I have to follow all the deposit rules. So not only do you have to be well within the limit of 100% PUC and FR, but also such company shall file the details of all the money, etc., in the manner specified in the notification. So you need to follow certain rules, only then you will be able to give the deposit. Next, acceptance of deposit from members under section 73, it will again not apply to, as already discussed, banking company, NBFC and other companies. Now, what is the condition for acceptance of deposit from the members? To pass an ordinary resolution, approval of RBI, circulate to all the members ROC with respect to the financial position of the company, credit rating, total number of depositors, amount due, everything. Company which fails to repay the deposits has to now go to, I can go to NCLT, I can also go with a thing called class action suit. All of us can come together and sue the company, and compensation will be granted by the National Company Law Tribunal. Just like we have capital redemption reserve account and debenture redemption reserve account, DRR, we also have one more DRR called deposit repayment reserve account. When I accept deposits, I should ensure that some part of it has to be repaid. So that company shall deposit it in a scheduled bank to a sum equal to 20% of the amount maturing during the following financial year. So next year, let's say 50 crore is maturing. So this year I have to keep how much balance? 10 CR, 20%, 10 CR. Such account shall be called as a deposit repayment reserve account. The deposit repayment reserve account shall not be utilized for any other purpose except for payment of deposits. Obviously, it cannot be used for any other purpose as such. So, the company can issue deposits, first of all, only if there is no default in the repayment of earlier set of deposits. It should not be like that, earlier I have taken deposits and I have not repaid, now again I want to issue deposits. It's all simple. When earlier only you have not done, which person will have the confidence to give you deposits this time? So previous deposits, if you have not repaid and all, this time you need to ensure that you repay, only then it will be allowed. Only then it will be allowed for you, is what they are trying to tell. Got it? Very simple. Company should provide security for the due repayment of the deposit. So it basically should be secured deposits. Secured deposits. It should be secured deposits. It should not be unsecured deposits. Secured against certain things, certain assets that you have. Then apart from that, time limit. What is the maximum period? repayable on demand, minimum period is 6 months, maximum period is 36 months. So that is all, you can accept the deposit. Short term requirements can be done for less than 6 months, but minimum 3 months. So deposit you can't take for 5 years, 6 years and all those things. Minimum period 6 months, maximum 36 months. All these questions can come in MCQ. All these questions can come in MCQ, right? In MCQ questions, these are important. So we need to see. Now, can I accept deposits for short term, you know, requirements? Yes, I can go below 6 months, but minimum I should keep at 3 months. Minimum I should keep for 3 months. It should not be less than 6 months, minimum 3 months. That's what they're trying to tell. Next. Deposit may be accepted in joint names also, but not exceeding 3%. So, 3 joint deposit holders can have a deposit. So, no company in that 73(2) shall accept or renew exceeding 30% of the paid up share capital and reserves. So, whatever companies that I told you, maximum they can give how much? 30% of paid up share capital and free reserves. Again, this is net worth. Again, this is net worth. But I have already discussed, private company can accept up to 100% of net worth from the members. Private company from members 100%. Normal other companies maximum 35% of net worth. 35% of net worth. That's what they say. Then deposit again. No eligible company shall accept or renew. This is for the eligible company, guys. This is for which company? This company. This company. Net worth minimum 100 crore or turnover minimum 500 crore. Net worth 100 crore or turnover 500 crore. Such company, no eligible company shall accept or renew deposit from its members, that is deposit amount plus outstanding deposit on the acceptance or renewal greater than 10% of the net worth or other deposits. This is deposit from the member maximum 10%, deposits from others all put together maximum 25%. If you add 10 plus 25, automatically it comes to 35%. So that's the logic. That 35% is split into 10% for members and others, you know, it will be 25% is what they say. Government company shall be eligible to accept deposits. For government company it is 35%, same. So basically everything is the same, guys, 35%, and for eligible company 10 and 25%, whereas private company can take how much? 100%, 100% of the net worth. Then rate of interest, interest brokerage etc. should be as per the SEBI regulations, and it shall at least once in a year obtain the credit rating from the credit rating agency. And along with this, every company or every eligible company, to maintain the, you know, deposit holders, I need to have a deposit trustee. I need to have a trust deed and appoint a deposit trustee, and shall execute the entire trust deed in a form called DPT2, 7 days before issuing a circular. So certain persons are not to be appointed as a deposit trustee. Who all? Director of the company cannot be the trustee. So all the deposit holders will be in a group, and this will be represented by a deposit trustee. And that trustee cannot be the director of the company, cannot be a person related to the company in any way, cannot be a person indebted to the company in any way, or its holding company, subsidiary, associate company, or anything of that matter. Anybody who has material pecuniary relationship, pecuniary means financial relationship. Anybody who has financial relationship with the company cannot take up the deposit thing. Has entered into any guarantee arrangement in respect of principal debt, all these things not possible. This is similar to your whatever is there in auditing, similar is provisions, and also whatever is there in independent director for CA final, same provisions are there for deposits. So moving on, in as far as deposits are concerned, what other things to be kept in mind in deposits, let's see. So the deposit trustee should ensure that the assets are sufficient to cover the repayment along with the principal and interest. he should ensure that, and he should also see that the deposit circular does not contain anything which is inconsistent with the provisions of the trust and all those things. And he should resolve the grievances. Basically, he looks after the interest of the deposit holders. That's what he does. Then the meetings of the deposit holders also will keep on happening through the debenture trustee, through the deposit trustee. And how many people can request for a meeting? If 1/10 of the deposit holders, that is 10% of the deposit holders, request for a meeting, then meeting should be held. Apart from that, that's the thing. Return of deposits shall be filed in form DPT-3. It is DPT-3, right? DPT-3, that's the thing. And there should be a register of deposits also, which should have all the cases. Finally, in case you do not pay any deposits, then it will be kept, interest will be at the rate of 18% per annum. 18% per annum. Without fail, you have to pay interest. Remember, yesterday also we saw various percentages. We saw 12%, we saw 15%. 12% was one chapter number 3. That is for your private placement. 15% is if the allotment money is not paid on time, if you are not refunded. Remember, within 60 days you have to refund where the issue is underwritten. And if you, within 60 days you have to allot, if you don't allot, then from 15 days it will be kept, it will be refunded within 15 days. 60 plus 15, from the 76th day onwards, interest will be levied at 15% per annum. So 15 we saw there. Private placement you saw 12%, and that is from the date of the expiry of the 60th day. Now we are seeing penal rate of interest if you do not pay deposits. The day you are supposed to pay, 18% interest, crazy rate of interest. So the company cannot take the deposits and cheat the public is what they are trying to tell. And other things, the deposit register should be kept for how long if they ask you? It should be kept for 8 years. It shall be kept for 8 years from the financial thing. That's what it says. So that is with respect to deposit buddies. With that, we finish. I told you, chapter number 5 is very easy. Deposit chapter. Deposit question may or may not come. Even if it comes, it's very simple. It will come. Even if it comes, it's for around 4 marks. But some couple of attempts have not asked also. But if they ask, it will be some 4 to 6 marks maximum. That is with respect to deposit chapter. Are you guys understanding? Right. Next, let us go into chapter number 6. Chapter number 6 talks about charges. Charges. So, what do you mean by this, guys? Very simple. Let's take, let's say, a group of debenture holders. Debenture holders will be represented by a debenture trustee. Debenture trustee along with the company will sign something called as a debenture trust deed, based on which the company would have given certain, issued certain debentures, and the debenture trustee, through the debenture holders of course, would have invested money, 7%, 8%, whatever. This debentures should be secured. Based on what? Based on the assets of the company. Based on the assets of the company, this has to be secured. Which means what? The debenture trustee should tell, look boss, I have a right over the assets of the company. I have the right over the assets of the company. If you do not, pay me my debentures. You have issued debentures. If you do not redeem the debentures, if you do not give me my money back, along with the interest that you have promised, I will take over the assets of the company. What is the right? How do you know that I have the right? That right itself in legal language is called a charge. And the person who holds the charge now will be the debenture holder, charge holder. Should this charge be registered with the ROC? Yes. When you have repaid completely, should I cancel this charge? Yes. If company has not repaid, should I enforce the charge? Yes. So that is the concept of charges. Very, very simple, guys. Charges is a very simple chapter. Nothing to worry. So let's see. Charges. Charge means a security given for securing loans or debentures by way of mortgage on his assets. Mortgage is generally for immovable property. Where the right of that particular immovable property is handed over to a charge holder, it is called charge. Now the same charge, the asset is valued at 100 crore. So debenture holder is just around 40 crore. So this 40 crore, he will have a charge over the 100 crore property. This 40 crore will be called as the first charge. One more debenture holder or one more person who has given loan to the company will say, I also want a security. So he would have given a loan of 20 CR. So that 20 CR also will come and take a charge on these assets. This charge will be called as second charge, like that. So in the event of, what do you say, non-payment, first the debenture holder will take over the assets of the company, sell the assets of the company for 100 CR, he will keep his 40 CR and then give the rest to the second charge holder through the company. Next, second charge holder will take his 20 crore and give it to the company back, or to the third charge holder if need be. So first charge holder, second charge holder, third charge holder, it keeps on, you know, increasing like that. That's how we need to keep in mind. Okay. So if you see here, what is a charge? Means an interest or lien created on the property or the assets of the company, including a mortgage. Charge can be on an immovable property, it's called mortgage. Charge can be on a movable property also, that is called hypothecation, and all these things which you would have studied. Charge, there are two types of charges, guys. One is called a floating charge, one is called a fixed charge. Fixed charge is generally over ascertained assets or fixed assets like building, plant, machinery and all those things. Floating charge is generally a charge on any class of assets, especially movable property. It is predominantly for a immovable property. So that is with respect to charge as such. So floating charge and fixed charge, what are the other features? Let us see. Now, floating charge is on what? It is on the assets of the company, like goods, stock. On stock of the company, let's say the company has stock worth 100 CR. Can I have a right over the asset? Yes. That is technically called as hypothecation. I have given a loan to you based on the strength of your stock, your closing stock. Now the question is, every time you want to sell the closing stock, do you have to ask the banker saying that, sir, you had given me a loan of 100 CR and I obviously, you have a right over my stock also 100 CR. Sir, can I sell this one item? Should you ask? No. In a hypothecation or in a floating charge, no need to seek any permission while disposing of the assets because it's based on overall balance. On the other hand, when the floating charge is converted to fixed charge is generally on assets, on your fixed assets. Fixed assets, if you are touching, you have to ask the charge holder. So when the floating charge is converted to fixed charge, that concept is called crystallization. So what do you mean by crystallization? Conversion of floating charge into fixed charge. Conversion of floating charge into fixed charge. Conversion of floating to fixed is called crystallization. And when will it come? This is an important question. 4 marks, they regularly ask this question, guys. What is the concept of crystallization of charge? So means conversion of floating charge into fixed charge is called crystallization. When the company goes into liquidation, all the floating charges will automatically be converted to fixed charge. and the company goes into liquidation, all the floating charge will automatically get into fixed charge. When the company ceases to carry on any business, it's not carrying on any business now, floating charge will be converted to fixed charge. Creditors or debt holders have taken steps to enforce their security on the happening of any event specified in the deed. In the deed, if any event happens, happening of an event, construction of the building or whatever the case may be, creditors or any event, it says on the death of a director, you can enforce the charge. So in one of the director dies, main director, now for example, I'm saying in Reliance, you will not care about Reliance as much as you care about Mukesh Ambani. If anything were to happen to Mukesh Ambani, Reliance would really collapse. So if there is a thing in the deed saying that if one of the main directors, something happened to him, then the floating charge will be automatically converted to fixed charge. I will take control of the assets of the company because I have lent you so much money based on the faith of not just the company, but also the director. So in these three cases, what happens, guys? The floating charge will be converted to fixed charge. The floating charge will be converted to fixed charge. That concept of conversion of floating charge to fixed charge is called as crystallization of charge. Crystallization of charge. Now, I need to register the charge first. I need to register the charge. Who needs to register? Company. Company fails to register, then the charge holder will call him up and say, look sir, I have given you a loan purely based on the charge. I know that I have a right over this asset, but until the ROC know, what is the guarantee that tomorrow if you do not pay me, what is the guarantee that I can take over your assets? That is why please register the charge. The registration of charge is the burden or the onus is on the company. But if they don't do it, the charge holder, in my example, the debenture holder should come to the company and say, boss, immediately register the charge with the ROC. So if you see, when a company fails to register the charge, the person in whose favor the charge is created, charge holder, may apply to the ROC in CHG 1 or CHG 9. Company may give notice, ROC may give notice to the company, and company may itself register the charge or so show sufficient cause as to why the charge should be registered, should not be registered, and all those things. Whatever it is, after giving 14 days notice and 14 days time after the notice, registration fee will be collected and then you will, you know, create the charge. And once you register, ROC will issue the certificate under CHG 2. That is for registration of charge. They'll give you a certificate saying that you have taken so and so loan and this person is the charge holder. Can I modify the charge if I take extra money or if the charge is released to some extent? That is called modification of charge. Once the debentures in my example are fully repaid, or once any person who has given a loan, he has been fully repaid, then the charge has to be cancelled. That is called as satisfaction of charge. The company shall give intimation to the ROC of the payment made within 30 days in form CHG 4. ROC shall issue a notice to the holder of the charge. Charge holder to reply within 14 days saying that yes, I have received the money. If no reply is received, ROC will enter the register and it will be deemed to be satisfied. Same will be given back. So in respect of everything, I need to maintain a register of charges and keep updating it online. And now the question is, when the charge exists and any person acquires such property, asset or undertaking, means what? The debenture holder had power over the asset of the company. Now rather the asset, what did the company do? Sold it off to another person. Should another person know about the charge? Answer is yes. Tomorrow when I go to him and say, boss, I actually had control over the asset and the company has in fact transferred it to you. I have control over the asset, not you. Please hand over the asset back to me. Can the another person say, I did not know about the charge only? No. As I told you, when you have filed the charge, CHG 1, 2, 3, all those things, it becomes a public documentation in the ROC website, in the MCA website. So you are entitled to know and you are bound to know who is the charge holder, what all is the charge amount, everything you should know. Tomorrow you cannot say, "I did not know about it." So section 80 says, "Where any charge exists already and such person has acquired property, asset or undertaking, such person," that is another person, "shall be deemed to have notice of the charge." He cannot tell that, "Sir, mother promised, I did not know. God promised, I did not know. No God promised, mother promised." He is definitely bound by it. He should know about the charge. And the moment now, what will I do? I will take, let's say, I have a right over your asset and you do not pay me the loan amount. You do not repay the amount. Can I take over your asset? Yes. When I want to take over the asset, then I will appoint a person called as a receiver or manager of the asset. He will take over those assets, sell it and give the charge holder money. Remaining money after all the charges, etc., will be paid back to the company. So within 30 days from the date of passing the order or of making appointment of receiver, such person shall give notice of such appointment to the company and the ROC. And what can the registrar do and what can the other fellow do? All that is the same. He can take over the assets, sell the assets and pay back the money. Now, as far as registration of the receiver, etc., ROC shall register the particular of the receiver, person, instrument, everything. And then, if the registrar is satisfied that in relation to the registered charge, debt has been repaid in full, or property charge has been released from the charge, or the property charge has ceased to be the property of the company, in any of these cases, he can record satisfaction of charge. Four mark question, what are the circumstances under which the concept of satisfaction of charge arises? First one, the debt should be repaid in full. Then obviously, charge, you are no longer a charge holder. Second one, the property charge has been released from the charge. Means, I am a charge holder, by writing a letter, I'll say, "I hereby release the charge, give me one more asset as a charge, this asset I will no longer continue." That may be one of the examples. Third one, property charged has ceased to be the property of the company. So the company has already sold it to one more person, of course, with knowledge that the charge already exists, everything. If this agreement, if such an agreement is there, then the satisfaction of charge will happen. Next, notice to the all the parties and of course, punishment for contravention, we'll see. Notice to the parties. Within 30 days of recording satisfaction of charge, I shall inform all the parties concerned that the charge has been fulfilled. Charge has been fulfilled. And next part here, punishment for every default. Punishment, what happens? Every officer in default, imprisonment up to 6 months or minimum fine 25,000, maximum 1 lakh or both. Now, if any person willfully furnishes any false or incorrect information, automatically it goes to 447. Where public interest is not involved, 6 months to 10 years. And one time to three times the amount of fraud. If public interest is involved, the 6 months will become 3 years. 3 years to 10 years and one time to three times the amount of fraud is what they have to say. Then, section 87 talks about the extension of time and condonation of delay. So basically, if I have already satisfied the charge, but I have not informed the ROC saying that full amount has been repaid already, that is one pass. Omission to give intimation of satisfaction. There is some omission or misstatement on the, in particulars of any filing, etc., in respect to registration, modification, satisfaction, then the CG can extend the time or grant a condonation. Condonation means to forgive. Condonation means to forgive. Very interesting to observe, guys, very interesting to observe. If I make a delay in registering the charge, if I make a delay in registering the charge, can I apply for condonation? Answer is no. If I make a delay in registering the charge, I cannot go for condonation. Condonation is only for, I have completely repaid, company has repaid the full amount. Then the director or the, sorry, or the charge holder, he makes it, you know, little slight delay, makes a slight delay in informing the registrar. Then it's okay. Anyway, you got your money back. Then only condonation. But I am the charge holder today, I have to register. I did not register on time. Then what do you think? Then I will give intimation for satisfaction of charge. That's the thing. Now, very, very important area. This was a new amendment which came couple of many, a few years back. 22nd November 2018. But after that changes, you know, in the thing, these change. Earlier what was there? Now what is there? Both we have to see. We have to understand. Yeah. So if you see, that's the thing. New norms with respect to charge creation or charge modification. What is this, guys? Other things. Before 2nd November 2018, what was the scene? After 2nd November 2018, what is the scene? Before 2nd November, what was it? After 2nd November. In the exam now, I have to write this. But if they ask you sometimes, what was the scene before 2nd November 2018? This was what was it? Hear me out. How is it? What was there previously, you leave. If you had created a charge before 2nd November 2018, let us say in August 2018, you had created a charge. Means you had taken a loan from somebody else and you had created a charge. Once the charge is created, within 30 days, you have to file CHG1. Right? 30 days you have to create the charge. If CHG1 is not filed, I will give you 300 days to file. In that 300 days, ROC may allow to go with additional fee. He may allow you to do so, but with additional fee. Now the question is, see, in August 2018 means you did not do. August to September you should have done. 30 days you did not do. Ideally, you have time from September to almost like 300 days. Now what they are trying to tell? On 2nd November 2018, the rule came which said that all that 300 days nonsense will no longer be there. From 2nd November 2018, for 6 months only time, within 6 months you shall register the charge. Means as on 1st May 2019, you should register the charge. This is not so relevant. This I explain only for your knowledge. What is really important is this. From now, once the charge is created, I will give you 30 days to register the charge, CHG1 along with the fee. If you don't register the charge within that day, within 60 days, ROC may allow, discretionary, may allow with an additional fee. That's all. No 300 days. 30 days you have to file. If you don't file, 60 days time. To do what? To allow additional fee. You have not done that within whatever 60 days. Then the registrar may allow within further 60 days. Basically, first 30 days, then 60 days, then extra 60 days. But this extra 60 days, I will charge a ad valorem fee. Ad valorem means based on the value of the charge amount. If it is 10 crore, 20 crore, 30 crore, 50 crore, based on that amount and the authorized capital of the company, etc., you will have to pay. I already told you most important rule, if you do not register the charge, earlier you could have begged and asked for forgiving. Now condonation under section 87 is not applicable. you will not get any condonation for not registering the charge. Got it, buddies? So this is the important area with respect to charges. With that, we have also finished with that particular question, with this charge creation. We have also finished which chapter? Charges chapter. Very, very simple. So now, buddies, we will go into a very, very important, very, very interesting area, management and administration. It obviously is a huge chapter, one of the largest chapters in company law. Very, very important. Questions will come definitely. Chapter number 7, 8, 9, 10 are incredibly important, of which 8, 9, 10 will also come in auditing. Dividend accounts audit. Dividend accounts audit will come both in auditing as well as law. Chapter 7, on the other hand, will definitely come in law. And it is extremely important in the context of understanding the subject. So, without further ado, let us dive into chapter number 7. Shall we? Are you guys there, buddies? No reply today. You are definitely replying. But then, where is the Josh? Come on, guys. Ready? Shall we do it? Yes. So, let us see chapter number 7, Management and Administration. Starts from section 88. So till 87 we have discussed. It starts with section 88, goes on till 122. Right? 88 to 122. Let us see. Register of members. So first it only talks about register. It is very simple. This we can quickly go through. But where we need to slow down, it will be all this AGM, EGM and all those points. Let's see. Power. Register to be maintained by every company. So, as per section 88, you have to maintain a register of members, debenture holders or security holders. What? Members, you know, you have to do. Members, you should have a register for separate for each class of equity shareholders, each class of preference shareholders. That should be in form number MGT1. Form number MGT1. Debenture holders or other security holders separately for each type of debenture in form number MGT2. Right? So, first one is for equity shareholder and preference shareholder, form number MGT1. For other cases, separately in debenture in form number MGT2 and other things. So, register maintained by the depository is deemed to be the register maintained under this section. I told you in a stock market scenario, it is held by NSDL or CDSL. He is called as the depository. Obviously, many banks will be under him. That is called depository participant. Under each of those banks, you will have a DMAT account. Just like a normal bank account, you can open in so many banks. DMAT account also, you can open in so many banks. Not a problem, right? That's the thing. So, that's the register holder. Remember, register. So, this has to be maintained. There has to be an index. The number of members is 50 or more. There should be an index, timely entries and all that have to be maintained. Place of maintenance, it should always be in the company's registered office. But if you pass a special resolution, then it can be maintained at any other place within the city, town or village in which the registered office is situated. Or any other place in India in which more than 1/10 of the total number of members reside. Important point. Where can I keep the register? I can either keep the register always at the registered office. It should be in the registered office. Right? Now, if I cannot do it at the registered office, then I have to pass a special resolution. If I pass a special resolution, then it will be in two places. Can be. One, where any other place within the city, town or village in which the registered office is situated. So any other place. Within the town means I should either keep, let us say my registered office is in Malleshwaram, Bangalore. Then no problem. If I want to keep it in Jayanagar, Bangalore, the register of members, then I have to pass what? A special resolution. Or I want to keep it in Goa. Oh, Goa I will keep my register of members. I will keep it there only if Goa represents at least 10% of the total members. If the number of members are 1000, 102 are in Goa, 40 are in is in Bangalore, 180 is in Rajasthan, and Bangalore is a registered office. I can definitely keep in Bangalore because it's a registered office. Number does not matter. In Tamil Nadu, 40 people are there. Can I keep in Tamil Nadu? No. Even if I pass in special, pass a special resolution, can I keep in Tamil Nadu? No. But I can keep in Goa and Rajasthan provided I pass a special resolution. Why? Because 1/10 of the, more than 1/10 of the total members reside. 1/10 means 10%. This is important, guys. They have asked couple of times in the exam. Next. Time for entries. When should I make the entries? Within 7 days from the approval of the board, allotment of shares, allotment of debentures, whenever I allot, forfeit, etc., within 7 days I have to make. And in case of listing in the stock exchange where it is pledged, etc., then it is 15 days. 7 days and 15 days is the time limit. Very simple. Now, interesting concept of beneficial owner and significant beneficial owner. Again, important section 89 and 90. Beneficial owner and significant beneficial owner. BO and SBO. BO and SBO. What is it? We'll see. Beneficial owner and significant beneficial owner. What is it? There was a company called Rendezvous Sports Private Limited. It had this, IPL team called Kochi Tuskers, if you remember. One of the directors of the board was Dr. Sunanda Pushkar, who was given some, you know, huge amount of dollars worth of shares. These people tried analyzing. Suddenly Kochi Tuskers came into force, suddenly it went. They realized this was because of the blessings of one person, member of parliament that time, Dr. Shashi Tharoor. Dr. Shashi Tharoor apparently, it's an allegation that because of him Kochi Tuskers came into play, and this huge amount of dollars shares given to Sunanda Pushkar was also because of Shashi Tharoor, because Sunanda Pushkar happened to be the wife of Dr. Shashi Tharoor. Now the question is, between Shashi Tharoor and Dr. Sunanda Pushkar, there happened to be so many intricate companies, small companies. These were all sham companies. The government and the CBI tried figuring out, not possible. The only person who knew about the entire deal was Dr. Sunanda Pushkar, who was found dead in a Delhi hotel, Taj Hotel. There are two cases still pending against Shashi Tharoor, in which one he came out from. One is this entire sham companies, one more is the murder cum suicide case. I am just stating the facts. This is not a political discussion. right? I don't care about Congress, BJP and all those things. Whoever, you know, the, whatever, this was the facts of the case I am stating. So that is what Shashi Tharoor, was alleged to have done. Now anyway, to curb such things from happening, they said boss Sunanda Pushkar is not the owner actually. Ideal owner is Shashi Tharoor. Nobody else. So, though the holder of shares, holder of shares is Dr. Sunanda Pushkar. Though the holder of shares is Dr. Sunanda Pushkar, the main owner to whom the benefits go, the owner to whom the benefits go, that is Dr. Shashi Tharoor. Right? So Shashi Tharoor gets the benefits. So he is called as the beneficial owner. So to understand the concept of beneficial owner and one more concept of significant beneficial owner, we have two sections, 89 and 90. 89 and 90. 89 and 90. So that is what we need to understand now. 89 and 90. Let's see. Duties of registered owner and beneficial owner. So, who is a registered owner? Name of the person entered in the register of members. That is Dr. Sunanda Pushkar. Holder of shares. Who is a beneficial owner? Who actually acquires a beneficial interest. Means what? All the dividends, the true owner is Shashi Tharoor. Registered owner shall file a declaration to the company. Now, what they are trying to tell? No, that the beneficial owner, Shashi Tharoor himself, should stand up and say, I am indirectly holding shares in these many companies. So the beneficial owner should file MGT5, whereas the registered owner should file MGT4. These are the two important areas, MGT4, MGT5. Penalty, if you do not, you know, say that you are a registered owner, maximum 50,000 rupees. For continuing default, 1,000 rupees per day. If Shashi Tharoor does not say that I am the owner and all that, minimum 500 rupees, maximum 1,000, that's okay. But for continuing default, 1,000 rupees per day. This is for normal beneficial owner. But significant beneficial owner. And also there is a concept of fraud. If you commit, then directly it will go to 447. Can central government investigate also into the affairs of the company? Yes. So your penalty may be small, guys, but then see, 447 also will come later if it's fraud. And also the company can investigate into the affairs of the central government can investigate into the affairs of the company. So that's what, if it appears to CG that there are reasons to do so, they may appoint an inspector to investigate. Who is a significant beneficial owner? This is again important. So if the reporting company is Rendezvous Sports Private Limited, Rendezvous Sports Private Limited, what does it say? So SPO, Mr. A, indirect holding. Rendezvous Sports Private Limited is a reporting company. And then SBO, significant beneficial owner, is what? Mr. A, how do we see? So if you take the same example, this is what, guys, Shashi Tharoor. If Shashi Tharoor is holding more than 50% shares in a body corporate, Let's say Katarnak English Limited, simply that fellow speaks English like that, no. If Shashi Tharoor holds more than 50% in Katarnak English Limited and Katarnak English Limited holds minimum 10% in Rendezvous Sports Private Limited, see indirect holding, then Shashi Tharoor has to disclose. Second, if Shashi Tharoor is the karta of a Hindu undivided family and the Hindu undivided family is holding minimum 10% in Rendezvous Sports Private Limited, then the same. Next, that body corporate company is holding, is a partner of the partnership firm and that has 10% in the reporting company, same. If Mr. A is a trust in the trustee and that trust is holding minimum 10% in Rendezvous Sports Private Limited, same, then Shashi Tharoor is deemed to be the significant beneficial owner. Shashi Tharoor is a partner of a partnership firm. Partnership firm is holding 10% in the reporting company. Then again, it is the same. So, if you see, there are the various tests for the SBO disclosures. What you should understand, okay, first of all, what's a body corporate? It is a private company, public company, statutory corporation, foreign company, limited liability partnership, nationalized bank and financial institution. All these together are called as bodies corporate individually, right? So, what is the SBO disclosure that you have to do? SBO means what, guys? Significant beneficial owner. What is SBO disclosure? First of all, there has to be a natural person. You should be a natural person, Shashi Tharoor. You should be an individual having beneficial interest, means the benefit should come to you. You should be having what interest? Beneficial interest. And of minimum how much? 10%. You should have indirect holding. Directly if you hold, you are not a beneficial owner, you are a direct owner. You are a significant beneficial owner if you have how much? Indirectly shares. Share capital includes what all? We have global depository receipts, compulsorily convertible debentures, compulsorily convertible preference shares. All these things. And then individual should hold majority stake in member body corporate. Majority stake is what? More than 50%. Only direct holding of shares shall not be considered as SBO. Only direct holding of shares shall not be considered as SBO. It should be indirect holding. Direct holding is not to be considered, only indirect holding. So, these are the things that we need to keep in mind. Right? Very, very important area, guys. Hope you understood SBO. Next. Section 91. Closure of register of members. Very simple. So, will I close the register? Yes. Company shall give notice for at least 7 days or a lesser period. It will be closed for how many days? Maximum 45 days in every year, but not exceeding 30 days at a time. Which means I can close 15 plus 15 plus 15 like that, or I can close 30 plus 15. I cannot close it for more than 45 days in each year. Closure of where the register will not be updated, etc. Advertisement has to be given in a vernacular newspaper and English newspaper as well circulating in that district. I have to display it in the website as well. And I should give a notice, only then I can close the register. That is with respect to closure, very simple provision. Next, moving on to an important area of annual return. Annual return is given in MGT 7. Annual return, if you don't file, many things will happen. You should always file an annual return. So, what is annual return? Details about the registered office, particulars about the holding company, subsidiary company, associate company, all that should be shared in that. Shares, debenture, security, shareholding pattern should be given. Indebtedness should be granted. Promoters, directors, KMP and all these things should be given. Meetings of members and directors, all the meetings I should give. Remuneration of directors and KMP. That also should be granted. Penalty or punishment, all these things should be given. Remuneration of directors and KMP, that also has to be mentioned carefully. It should be signed by, this can be a separate question, who all should sign? Who all should sign? That also should be clearly given, who all should sign? First, a director and a CS. Director and a CS, both should sign. For one person company and small company. What is a small company? It is a private company where paid up capital is less than or equal to 50 lakh rupees and turnover less than or equal to 2 CR. Paid up capital less than or equal to 50 lakh rupees and turnover is less than or equal to 2 CR. For one person company and small company, it should be signed by a company secretary. If not signed by company secretary, then signed by the director of the company. Director of the company. So, director and CS. Then, a company secretary should certify. This is for a practicing company secretary should certify. This is the company secretary of the company. This is a practicing company secretary. Different company secretary. It is applicable for listed companies or companies having paid up share capital greater than 10 lakhs and turnover greater than or equal to 5 CR. These are all MCQ questions. Form number MGT 8. MGT 7 is for annual return. For certification by company secretary, it is MGT 8. It shall be certified by a company secretary in practice. So, penalty for wrong certification is 50,000 to 5 lakhs is what they say. Filing with the ROC, a copy of the annual return shall be filed with the ROC within 60 days from the date of AGM. That is what is in MGT 7. This you have to remember the name, important. Remember the timeline, within 60 days. If AGM is not held, then within 60 days from the date where AGM should have been held, means the last date on which AGM should have been held, within that 60 days. Then extract of the board report also should be there in MGT 9. All these are important areas for annual returns under section 92. Very, very simple. If you don't file annual returns, what will happen is the next question. Basically, company will be liable for minimum 50,000, maximum 5 lakh. Every officer, 6 months imprisonment or fine or both. 6 months imprisonment or fine or both is what they are trying to tell. Then section 94, register and returns, place of keeping. Now all these registers, where should I keep, sir? Where should I keep, etc., shall be actually prima facie evidence. If this is not there, no, tomorrow, can I use this as evidence in the court of law? Yes. See guys, why I am doing these things slowly and in depth is, these are the areas which we ignore and this only they ask in the exam. You will study all the heavy duty interesting chapters like dividend, accounts, auditing and all and go. They will ask small questions like this. This is the most ignored area in this chapters. So I want to pick those items and do it because I am doing everything anyway, but in these items I am going slow and trying to explain because these are the areas which they pick and give. So let us not be lax and let us not think that area from these areas questions will not come. Questions will definitely come. So you have to be very, very careful. Right? So register indices and copies of annual returns. It shall be done when? Prima facie evidence. Means prima facie means what? On the face of it. On the face of it, it will be evidence. When will you, where will you maintain this? Place of maintenance. You will maintain it at the registered office of the company and any other place in India in which more than 10% of the total members, I told you already, same thing, approved by special resolution, copy will be filed in MGT 14. Period of maintenance, how long will I maintain, sir? Maintenance of the other registers will be, all the registers will be permanent. It is important, permanent. All that deposit, other register and all, I told you, previous chapter, charges, etc. Was when? Some 8 years. Even books of accounts actually, and as per 128 is 8 years. But these other registers that I told you, members, etc. will be preserved permanently. On the other hand, register of debenture holders, foreign register of debenture holders, annual returns and certificate will be for 8 years. For debentures or securities, it is 8 years. For normal register of members, etc., it is, you know, the other registers will be permanent. Got it? Custody of registers, with whom will it be? Company secretary or any other person? Can anybody inspect the registers? Yes, any member, debenture holder, security holder without any payment, or any other person. I want to register. Yes, I can do. 50 rupees per inspection. 50 rupees. And of course, that any other person should be given in the articles, empowered in the articles. At least 2 business hours I can take and I can extract it, no problem. I can give an extraction also without any payment of the fees, no problem. Furnishing copies on request. Member, debenture holder, other security holder can take copies of any of these documents at 10 rupees per page maximum. Company has to pay within, do it within 7 days. If you do not heed this request, central government can direct immediate inspection. Company and every officer has to pay maximum 1 lakh and minimum 10,000 rupees per day. Imagine, if I say I want the copy, give me a copy, I'll pay also. And you don't give me those details. How much? 10,000 rupees per day. Dangerous. 10,000 rupees per day. Right? So, all these areas are very, very important areas. Now comes, guys, very, very, very important stuff. Annual general meeting. Annual general meeting. Extraordinary general meeting, all these things. Let us see. When can the first AGM be held? When can the subsequent AGM be held? The first AGM can be held within 9 months from the end of financial year. If the financial year is 31st March 21, within 9 months, that is from 31st December 21. You can hold the first annual general meeting. What about the subsequent AGM? All the 3 conditions must be satisfied. This is the interpretation of statute, harmonious construction. One AGM should be held every calendar year. Gap between 2 AGMs maximum must be 15 months. But with an ROC extension, you can go by 3 more months, 15 plus 3, 18. And it should be held 6 months from the end of financial year. So, ROC extension is by 3 months. So, 15 plus 3 and then ROC extension 6 plus 3, 9 months, whichever is earlier. This whichever is earlier only is the concept of harmonious construction. One AGM every calendar year. So, if you see there, last, for example, for the year 2020, let us assume the meeting was held on 31st October 2020. For the year ended 31st March 21, this is for the year ended 31st March 20, this was Corona year. For the 31st March 21, when can you hold the meeting. First is what? One AGM every calendar year, means maximum you can hold 31st December 21. Second, gap between two AGMs should not exceed 15 months. So from 31st October 20 to 31st October 21 is 12 months, November, December, January. So 31st Jan 22, third one, gap, I mean from the financial year 6 months, 31st March 21, 6 months, 30th September 21. In order to fulfill all the three conditions, I have to use whichever is earlier. And which is earlier now? 30th September 21. With an addition of 3 months, extension of 3 months, this can go up to 31st December 21. That's it. Whichever here, because whichever is earlier is this only, because it is the next January, no? That's why. Got it? So that is when you can hold the annual general meeting. So one AGM every calendar year, gap between two AGMs, maximum 15 months. So ROC extension can be taken 3 months, 6 months, all that fine. When can you hold the AGM, time and place? Original meeting can be held, should be held only during business hours, 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. Cannot be held on a national holiday. National holiday will be August 15th, then your Republic Day, Gandhi Jayanti, that's it. Unless some other day is declared as a national holiday by the government. As of now, these are only the national holidays. Registered office, or where should you hold it? Registered office or the place where registered office is situated. Outside India is not possible. See, all the section I have taken important pointers and put, so it becomes very easy. AGM can be held at any other place in India if it is allowed by a unanimous resolution and the company must be unlisted. Unlisted company can hold any other place in India. Need not be in the registered office only or the place where registered office is situated. Who should agree? Everyone should agree. Original meeting. Adjourned meeting, when can you hold? There are two types of adjournment. One is for want of quorum. Means the quorum cannot be met, could not be met. Quorum could not be met because people did not come, whoever was supposed to come, minimum number of people required to transact valid business could not come. So I will wait for 30 minutes, else automatic adjournment, same place, same time, next week. It can also be adjourned to a national holiday, doesn't matter. Board can also determine the time and place. On the other hand, other reasons, act is silent, board to decide, can be adjourned even to a national holiday. But it is interesting to note that for these two things and also everything, there is something under section 118.10 called SS, means secretarial standards. Secretarial standard, there are three standards as of now, SS1, SS2, SS3. SS3 is about dividend. SS1 is board meeting, SS2 is general meeting. So, should the company also follow the secretarial standards? Yes. So, as per the secretarial standards, they are trying to tell you that generally try to avoid a national holiday. They say that please try to avoid a national holiday. That you should try to avoid any national holiday as such. Because, you know, it will involve employees also should come, people also should come. So, it's a holiday across India. So, the SS suggests that please try to avoid anything which is a national holiday. So, national holiday you need to avoid is what they are trying to tell. So, that is with respect to which one, guys? 96, that is AGM, and when can you hold AGM, time, place, everything is also given in the AGM part. Next, coming to the financial year. Financial year, section 241. So, what does it say? Section 241. What do you mean by a financial year? Financial year means the period for which the financial statement of the company is made up. Financial year should always be 31st March of every year. But if the company is incorporated that year, let's say the company got incorporated on January 2021, you can't keep financial year as 31st March 2021. So the financial year should be ending on the 31st March of the following year. So this should be what? 31st March 22. 31st March 22. A company existing on the commencement of Companies Act shall within 2 years from such commencement align itself to the entire thing. Can I have a different financial year? If it is possible, yes, you should take the approval of the central government. They can allow you to have a different financial year, especially if you are a holding company in India, having a all subsidiaries outside India. In UK, etc., they follow year of January to December. So, can you also do that? It is, the answer is yes. Then, about as far the rules are concerned, you have to apply in RD1, rules, etc., we can go through. There is nothing great in that. Yes. Now, coming to AGM, if it is not held by the people, AGM has to be held if it is not held by the people concerned. Like company secretary doesn't call the AGM, board of directors don't call the AGM, what to do? If the AGM is not held, what to do? Just a sec guys, I'll change the batteries quickly. Yes, if the AGM is not held by, right, AGM is not held by any of these people, then what to do is the question. So, if the AGM is not held by these people, then power of the tribunal to call an AGM. The tribunal has the power to call an AGM. If any default is made in holding the AGM of the company, now under section 96, the tribunal may, on an application of any member of the company, call or direct the calling of an AGM. The tribunal themselves can call an AGM, provided such directions may include direction that one member of the company present in person or by proxy shall be deemed to constitute a meeting. Generally, can a meeting be there by one person? No. Here, the tribunal can say even a one member meeting is possible. Think about it. Tribunal can say even one member, because you did not call the meeting, I am going to punish you. How am I going to punish you? By making even one person call a meeting. So, if you see that, if any default is made in holding the AGM of the company, the tribunal may call or direct the calling of an AGM of the company even by one member of the company present in person or by proxy. Then, this is AGM. AGM is section 98. If any reason it is impracticable to call a meeting of the company other than AGM, then the tribunal may either suo motu. Suo motu means voluntary. Or on an application of any director or member of the company entitled to vote at the meeting, same, order a meeting. It can also be held by one person as well. If you don't hold the meeting, we have section 99, fine up to 1 lakh, continuing default 5000 rupees per day. 5000 per day you have to pay. These are all the provisions with respect to meetings. Now, who all can hold the meeting? What is this AGM? What are the rules of AGM, etc.? We will do it. But before that, I think it's time for us to, we've already had 1.5 hours of classes. Just take a short break. The short break, we will come back. 10 minutes, right? 10 minutes is enough, I think. Take a short break and come. Today's target, we need to try and finish as much as possible. We need to finish this chapter, guys. Chapter number 7. Alright? Take a break, buddies. See you soon. Take a break. See you soon. All right buddies, let's begin. All right, chalo, let's start. So, section 100 talk about what is EGM, extraordinary general meeting. Correct? Section 100 talks about extraordinary general meeting. One second. All right guys, yeah, now it's clear. So let's begin. Section 100, extraordinary general meeting, right? So who all can hold this extraordinary general meeting? All that we'll see. Extraordinary general meeting can be called by four types of people, or rather four types. One, EGM by board. Suo motu means voluntary. Second, EGM by board on requisition of the requisitionist. So the people who request for the meeting are called as requisitionist. So requisitionist can call the meeting. So that is called EGM by requisition, requisitionist. Third one, let's say the requisitionists do not call the meeting, whatever time given they do not call, then it is called by the board. I mean, basically, the first of all, first part is what board themselves call. Second, requisitionist request the company, that is the board, to call, then board will call. Third one, despite request of the requisitionist, board does not call, so the requisitionist themselves will call. In failure of the board, they themselves will call. And last part is by the tribunal. Last part is by the tribunal. So EGM by board on requisition, called by requisition is held by board. So these two are actually kind of similar only. Last one, called and held by requisitionist on failure of the board. And one more is by the tribunal. Tribunal, anyway, we have seen here. If you remember guys, 98 already seen tribunal calling the meeting. So tribunal calling the meeting is separate. We have already seen that portion, no tension. Now, AGM by board, voluntary they can call, by a normal board resolution, they can call a meeting, that's okay. EGM by board on requisition, and it is called by requisitionist, held by board. How many people should call the meeting? Requisitionist means shareholders having 1/10 of the share capital value. 10% of equity shareholders can call the meeting, right? The persons who can vote for the meeting, vote at the meeting, that is equity shareholders who have voting rights, obviously they themselves can call the meeting. So basically, how does it work? Very simple. If on the receipt of requisition, second one is what? That's what? Called by requisitionist. So what? Simple. I will give a notice. Who will give the notice? Requisition 1/10 value. The board, maximum 21 days, they have to send a notice of the meeting in 101. And the meeting will be what? At least 21 days before the meeting. The notice, sorry, notice will be at least 21 days before the meeting. We have already seen section 101, 21 clear days. So first of all, the moment requisition is received from the company, from the, you know, 1/10 of the value, the board within 21 days will send the notice. And the notice also will be for how many days? 21 days before the meeting. So totally, general meeting should be held 21 plus 21. Overall, maximum time as per law is 45 days. Are you able to understand? Right. Alright buddies. So, what is it? Based on the receipt of requisition, who will requisition 1/10 of the capital, they will requisition, and based on that 21 days I should send a notice of the general meeting. Notice of the general meeting should go under section 101, that should go at least 21 days before the meeting to the shareholders. So that is section 101. So 21 plus 21, maximum time limit is what? 45 days. That's it. That is called by requisitionist, held by board. Called by requisitionist, held by board. So one is what? EGM by board or suo motu. Second is EGM by board on requisition, called by requisitionist, held by board. Next is called and held by requisitionist on failure of the board. Called and held by requisitionist on failure of the board. Called and held by requisitionist on failure of the board. Means what? I told you, first if I requisition, you need to first hold the meeting. Now the board doesn't hold, so see here. First I have deposited the requisition. Correct? Maximum 20 days. There is no action by the board. Here maximum 21 days, what should you do? Notice you should send. Board has not sent only. The people who requested for the meeting is calling up the board and saying, sir, why aren't you sending? Why aren't you sending? They are not sending. So the requisitionist themselves can take matters into their hands and within 3 months can do what? Call the meeting. The gap between deposit of requisition and the general meeting should be maximum 3 months. Within 3 months, they can call the meeting. This is all about extraordinary general meeting. EGM of the board, suo motu, authority wise if you see, EGM can be called by board of director whenever it deems fit. Valid board resolution is required. In exceptional cases where quorum is not available, any director or two members may convene the EGM. 5 directors were there, let's say 3 directors, 4 directors died. Only 2 directors are there. Exceptional circumstances. Immediately they can call the extraordinary general meeting. Board shall give at least 21 days notice. We know that. We have already seen that. On requisition by members, 1/10 of the paid up capital or 1/10 of the voting power, 21 days before the meeting, they will give same thing. EGM time and place. We saw AGM time and place. Now the time has come to see EGM time and place. EGM time and place will be held by, the board is one. One is called by requisitionist, held by board. Third one is called and held by requisitionist. EGM which is called by requisitionist, tell me, board. Called by board, sorry. Original meeting can happen any place in India and it can happen on a national holiday also as per the act. But guys, as I told you, SS2 says kindly avoid national holiday since employees have to be there. So SS2 says it should be held within working hours only. Can I hold EGM outside India? Answer is yes. Foreign company with a wholly owned Indian subsidiary. Foreign company with a wholly owned Indian subsidiary can hold EGM. Outside India. AGM cannot be held outside India. AGM cannot be held outside India. EGM can be held outside India. Foreign company with a wholly owned Indian subsidiary. Foreign company with a wholly owned Indian subsidiary can hold the EGM outside India. AGM can be held, cannot be held outside India, should be held within India only. Got it? Now, as far as called by requisition is held by board or called and held by requisition is on failure of the board. Original as per SS2, it is similar to AGM provisions, cannot be held on national holiday, should be held only on business hours, 9 AM to 6 PM, should be held only in the registered office or any other place where the registered office is situated. Adjournment, if the quorum is not met within half an hour, then the meeting shall stand cancelled. Why? First of all, requisition is call a meeting and none of them are there. So what will happen? Meeting shall obviously be cancelled. There is no concept of adjournment. If the board calls, shareholders don't come, it's okay. But the requisitionists themselves have called for the meeting, nobody turns up. The people who called the meeting, they also don't turn up. So in that case, what happens? Meeting shall stand cancelled. There is no concept of adjournment. Concept of adjournment is not there. Right? That's the thing. Then coming to 101, already discussed, guys. What is this? Notice of the meeting. 21 clear days before the meeting. 21 plus 2 plus 2. 25 days. For which one? If I am sending via post. And 21 plus 2 only. If it is sending via, what do you say? Email. Right? That's the thing. And notice shall be given to every member, legal representative, insolvent member assignee. It should be given to auditor also. Every single meeting it should be sent to the auditor and every director of the company. By mistake, if I forget to send the notice, will it invalidate the proceedings of the meeting, guys? By mistake, if I forget to send. Accidental omission to give notice or the non-receipt of such meeting notice shall not invalidate the proceedings. By mistake, if I do not send, it will not invalidate. Who has to prove that it is by mistake? It has to be proven by the company. They should say that by mistake they did not send. So accidental omission will be pardoned, but willful omission will not be pardoned. As far as short notice is concerned, again important point, instead of 21 days, can I give less than 21 days? Possible. 95% of the members should give less than 21 days. 95% of members, mind you. So if there are, for example, 1000 people, of which 960 people have 40% of the shareholding and 40 people have, or let's say 960 people have just 4% of the shareholding and 40 people have 96% of the shareholding, then if 40 people give, is it a valid short notice? No. It says 95% of the members. Means 960 people should give. Even though they have 4% shareholding in my example, all 960 people or 950 people also, if they give, it's fine. 95% of the members is what they say. If it is EGM on the other hand, buddies, it is majority in number and 95% in value. Majority in number and 95% in value. Majority in number will be obviously in this example 501 plus 95% in value. 95% in value is what we need to see. Majority in number and 95% value. That's what we need to think. Majority in number and 95% value. Both the points we need to consider. Next, what are the procedure for giving notice by email? So by email, who all can give, what all can happen? Permitted modes, you can send via email or as a notification, as a resource locator, send an email and a PDF can be attached. So there are certain rules of sending via email and all that you can go through. That is, you know, just generic points. Now coming to section 102, we have already discussed this, types of businesses in the company. We have ordinary business and special business. Both have been discussed. Ordinary and special, both have been discussed already. What is ordinary business? Those adda or dada points at the AGM. Consideration of accounts, declaration of dividend, retirement of auditors, retirement of removal of auditors, removal of directors and all those things. And that is one part. Second part is, at any other general meeting, special business, it's always EGM, all businesses are called special. In an EGM, all businesses are called special, very, very simple. For all items of special business, I have to give an explanatory statement under 102. This is also very important, 4 marks question generally. What all will the explanatory statement contain? What all will the explanatory statement contain? So, explanatory statement will contain all the material facts, nature of the concern or interest. Nature means the exact amount of profit made. Exact amount of profit made by the director concerned also has to be disclosed. All the interest portion. So, if for example, X Limited is entering into a contract with Y Limited and the director X is also a director there. So, when I am sending it to the shareholders, I should disclose this fact saying that the director X is also director there. Since they are entering into a deal here, he is getting money from both the places, commission. So, that has to be clearly given. Nature of concern or interest, whether it is financial interest or otherwise, any other interest. Every director, every KMP, every relative, everything I need to discuss, relative of every director, has to be seen. Any other information and facts that may enable members to understand the scope, everything has to be given. If you do not disclose, then the contract again can get affected also, and all the KMP, every person will be 100% liable under the Act. Now comes another area which is again important, buddies. This is called quorum of the meeting. Quorum is under section 103. Quorum of the meeting. What is the quorum of any general meeting? Again, I have made a consolidated chart which makes it very, very simple for you to understand. This consolidated chart, if you study, becomes very, very easy for you to understand the quorum provisions. What are the quorum provisions? Quorum can be of a private company under 103(1)(b) or of a public company. And quorum can be of an original meeting or an adjourned meeting. Similarly, for public company also, it can be original meeting or adjourned meeting. What do you mean by quorum? 103 section is subject to articles. For a private company, the quorum provisions do not apply. For a private company, the quorum provisions do not apply means what? It will apply only to the extent of what is given in the articles. So, for section 103, I have to go to the articles. If articles are silent, then quorum will be as per the section. If articles are silent, then quorum will be as per the section. If articles are silent, if articles are silent, then what will be the quorum? 2 members personally present will be the quorum. If articles are silent, then 2 members personally present. Since they have given members personally present, proxies will not be counted. Since they have given members personally present, interesting to know, proxies will not be counted. Got it? Very, very simple. Proxies. Who are proxies? Now, if you cannot attend the meeting, you can ask somebody else to come for the meeting. They are called as proxies. So, proxies will not be counted in quorum. Apart from proxies, everybody else, the ones who come personally, they will be counted. Public company. One is original, one more is adjourned. What is the quorum for public company? Articles can fix a larger quorum in some cases. Instead of what is given in the act, articles can themselves fix a larger quorum. If articles are silent, then members, less than or equal to 1000 members, quorum is 5 minimum. If the number of members are more than 1000 but less than or equal to 5000, quorum will be 15. If it is members is more than 5000, quorum will be 30. So the key words buddies is called MPP, members personally present. Again, will proxies be counted in this? No, proxies will not be counted in this particular quorum provisions for public company. Now tell me, can article say instead of 5 I need 40 people here? Answer is yes. Articles can fix a larger quorum. If the meeting is adjourned, if the meeting is adjourned, let us say in the original meeting people do not come and in the adjourned meeting also people do not come, then they say concessional quorum is there under 1033. Minimum 2 members can form the quorum, and this also should ideally be read as personally present. On the other hand, other reasons, what are other reasons of adjournment? You know, people start fighting, suddenly, you know, one member sees one chappal is there, one more member sees mic has come, chairman turns around, chair only is not there, right? That is other reasons, fighting. In those cases, guys, if the original meeting there was quorum, adjourned meeting there was fighting, in those cases there is no concessional quorum. Important to know, concessional quorum is there when original meeting also quorum was not there, adjourned meeting also quorum is not there, then they say minimum 2 people. But if the original meeting there was quorum, adjourned meeting was adjourned for some other reason, right? Original meeting there was quorum but it was adjourned for fight, then in the adjourned meeting there is no concept of concessional quorum. Original quorum provisions, all this 1000, 5, 15, 30, that only has to be followed. That is with respect to quorum provisions. Chairman of the meeting will be elected by show of hands, or you can ask for a poll for election of the chairman. If a poll is demanded, whoever is the chairman at that time should mandatorily call a poll. Show of hands is one member, one vote. Poll is one share, one vote. Very, very simple. So, poll can again be demanded by persons having 10% of the voting power. Anyway, as far as proxy is concerned, who has the right to appoint a proxy? Any member entitled to attend and vote at the meeting, basically equity shareholder, can appoint a proxy who will be able to attend and vote at the meeting. Who can appoint a proxy? Person can be appointed as a proxy of not more than 50 members. One person can be a proxy for 50 people. I repeat, one person can be a proxy for 50 people. Holding in the aggregate not more than 10% of the total share capital. So, one person can be a proxy for 50 people. These 50 people together which should have less than 10% of the capital, share capital. Right? Holds that not more than means less than or equal to 10% of the share capital. What if they have more than? I am a proxy of, let's say, 10 people. These 10 people together have more than 10% of the share capital. Now the question is, can I go beyond 10? Answer is no. Or if one member only, guys, one member holds 12% share capital, can I be a proxy of that guy? Yes. Can I go beyond that? No. So if one member holds more than 10%, proxy can be appointed, but he cannot be a proxy for any other member. It is the duty of every company to give a notice of proxy and all these things. Then that form where you will write who should be the proxy, you will deposit it to the company at least 48 hours before the meeting. This 48 hours is fixed. Important to know that if the articles give anything beyond 48 hours or less than 48 hours, it is void. It is definitely void. So this, you can, the entire proxy form is called an instrument of proxy. That also can be given to them, no problem. Next, 106 talks about restriction of voting rights. So the AOA of a company provides that no member shall exercise voting rights on shares of which calls are not paid. This is very, very important section. They keep asking regularly, which are the cases where voting rights are there? Which are the cases where voting rights cannot be restricted? Can I restrict voting rights? Yes, first of all, it should be on the companies on which calls are not paid. If call money is not paid, then you will exercise your, you will restrict your voting rights. Second, any sum presently payable by him has not been paid. Means what? The shareholder has taken a loan from the company and the company has taken the shares as the security until you give back the loan. Now, if you do not repay the loan, this is some sum of money which is not paid. Fully paid shares only. So, can I exercise voting rights on those shares? Yes. Or the company has exercised the lien. These are the only three areas where voting rights can be restricted. Any other reason, for example, can I say, in this AGM, you do not have the power to vote because you just joined recently. This power to vote is only for the people who are in the company for at least 2 years. Can you have these conditions? No. These conditions will be called void ab initio. So, these conditions are void ab initio. These conditions cannot be done at any cost. This will 100% be void ab initio. Right? This is what you need to understand. All other things are okay. But this part is something that you really need to think of. Correct? That's the thing. Now, these are the three areas where the company can go for lien. These are the three areas where the company can go with a lien concept. Company can go with a lien concept. Lien concept, then, you know, restriction of vote concept. One is lien, one is where calls are not paid. Third one, whatever sum is presently payable has not been paid. So, these are the only three areas where the company can go with restriction of the voting rights. Restriction of the voting rights. Got it? That is 106. Then the various types of votings are all simple, guys. Voting by show of hands is one member, one vote. Generally, this is the simplest form of voting. Whoever wants to say yes can raise their hand. Whoever wants to say no also, and they ask you who wants to say no to this, they can raise their hand. Easiest way. But the problem is, I have 1 lakh shares. Still, I only have show of hands method, only one. You have one share, you also have one vote. So, here it is one member, one vote, not one share, one vote. That is show of hands. Apart from that, there is voice vote also. All of those in favor say aye. When I say, people who say yes, aye will say it's a yes. All of those not in favor so say no. So, if they say no, then it is a no. Voice vote and show of hands, etc. cannot be counted, etc. properly. So, generally the best possible method is poll method. So, anyone can demand a poll. I told you that 1/10 of the capital can demand a poll. If a poll is demanded, poll has to be taken. Can I vote through electronic means also? Yes. Electronic means, audiovisual means, and now due to COVID in 2020, recently, I mean, no, in 2020, they had this audiovisual method of voting. Also, AGM, EGM, etc. could be handled via video conferencing, all that they have added now. So, you can do via email method also, electronic means. So, they will send you the documentation, you just have to vote. So, email method also possible, right? Email method also is, it's not at all a problem, you can go ahead with it. Then, remote e-voting means what? Where you can cast the vote through an electronic voting system. There will be, for example, many, electronic voting machines installed in various parts of the city. So, you can go to that and do your, cast your vote there also. You can do it online also. So, all these are various concepts of the notice that we have to see. So, remote e-voting, again, shall remain open for not less than 3 days and shall close at 5 p.m. on the date of the date preceding the date of the meeting as such. So, once a member has cast his vote on a resolution, obviously he shall not be allowed to change it subsequently, or he cannot vote again also on that. Once you have already voted, you cannot change your vote, right? That's the problem. So e-voting is also one more mechanism of doing this particular voting. Now, to do all this, why I skipped all these things are, these are the basic regulations which you can go through. There is no point, you know, revising all this, there is nothing there in that, very basic regulation. So those two pages I am skipping, it's chilled out, no problem. It is just, it's there in your, all your rules, it's there in your textbook, it's like a story. You can read like a story, it'll end. But what is important here is, guys, to do this remote e-voting, to do the counting of the votes, I can appoint a person, or rather I should appoint a person called as a scrutinizer. Generally, he'll be a company secretary, but you can be a CA, CMA or CS. What will the scrutinizer do? He is basically a person who is not in employment of a company. He can scrutinize the thing. The scrutinizer will be appointed. He will take the assistance of the company and the, you know, the legal team, and he will count the votes. He will start counting the votes and he will say, count the valid votes, reject the invalid votes. If you have to say yes or no, if you have ticked for both the things, it will be invalid. Or yes, yes, you have ticked, or you have written yes, no, no, yes, no, no, all that, it will be discarded. He will record the assent or the dissent and he will check the register, and then he will give his final result. And that, based on that final result, that result will be declared. Very, very simple. Now, coming to demand by poll, again important, how many people can demand poll? I already told you, any person holding paid up capital 5 lakh or, as I told you, 1/10 of the voting power can demand poll. Can a proxy also demand poll? 100% yes. A proxy also can demand a poll at the meeting. Absolutely no problem. Once you demand a poll, it can again be, you know, withdrawn by any person who has made the demand. Correct? Now, can he withdraw? Cannot withdraw is the question. So, may be withdrawn. So, you can say, no, no, I don't want the poll. Fine, leave it. So, you can withdraw the poll, no problem. Poll can be demanded for what? Adjournment of the meeting, or it can be based on the appointment of the chairman or any other matter. If it is for adjournment of the meeting or for appointment of chairman, it should be immediately taken. If it is for any other matter, for the item being discussed, etc., it should be taken within 48 hours is what they say. Result of the poll will be declared. Now, for listed companies, there is a mechanism of voting called postal ballot mechanism, where the documents will be sent via email or via post. You should go through the documents and say vote yes or no. So, many members in a general meeting, listed company cannot come. So, for them, it is a postal ballot. What is important for 4 mark is, they will ask you for what areas postal ballot is mandatory. So, for alteration in objects clause, alteration in AOA, change in registered office, buyback of share, election of director, for all these cases, I need to give importance to all the shareholders. Many shareholders cannot come for the meeting. So, what will I give? I have to do through a postal ballot mechanism. Any item of business other than ordinary business, means for special business, it is discretionary. And any business in respect of which director or auditor have a right to be heard at the meeting, etc., other than which. So, then if a director or auditor has to do, then you have to call a normal meeting. Otherwise, you can call a postal ballot. So, notice shall be placed, advertisement should be given, assent or dissent should be recorded, and you will pass the resolution via postal ballot without fail. Assent or dissent should be taken within 30 days from the date of passing the order, is what they say. OPC and other companies up to 200 members are not required to transact any business through postal ballot. Then the resolution that you pass, that is your ordinary resolution, special resolution, etc., will now, on requisition by writing of 1/10 of the voting power, will now be circulated to everybody, and it will be circulated to all the people, even requisitionists. And then company is not bound to circulate if at all you feel that that resolution you are trying to pull down the company, then no need to do so. This is section 111, circulation of the members resolution. Then, when it comes to proxy, if the president of India or governor of some state, governor of Karnataka for example, if they hold shares in the official capacity, can they send a proxy? Yes, they can. But this person is not called as a proxy. He will be called as a representative. Will this person's vote be counted? The answer is yes. This person's vote will definitely be counted. So the president or governor is a member in any other company. He may authorize another person to act as his representative. And that will definitely be counted. The person appointed will exercise the same rights, same liabilities and all those things. What if a company, can one company hold shares in another company? Yes. One company can hold shares in another company. In such a case, that company will not send any proxy because the company is an artificial person, company cannot attend. Company will send a representative. Will that representative be counted? Answer is yes. They will not be called as proxies as such. Now, resolutions already discussed. Ordinary resolution, special resolution. Notice should be given, votes cast in favor more than votes cast against, and those who are entitled and voting. We have seen that in the initial part. So what is ordinary resolution? A notice should be validly given under 101. The votes cast in favor must be more than the votes cast against, and those who are entitled and voting only should be taken into account. And what is special resolution? Under section 1142, notice must be given. The notice must mention that the intended resolution is special and 75% majority, those who are entitled and voting, means equity shareholders who are actually present and voting. Those who abstain from the meeting will not be counted. Whenever I pass special resolution, I will also file MGT 14 within 30 days. MGT 14 within 30 days. How will I cast the vote? I can cast the vote by show of hands method, poll, electronic or postal ballot. It can also be cast by members in person or proxies. Proxies can only vote on a poll. Proxies can never vote on show of hands. That is very important to understand. Then, many places, guys, we understand the concept of special notice. We need to understand what do you mean by special notice. Ordinary notice we know. Ordinary notice we know. But what we do not know is concept of special notice. So that is one part we will discuss now. Special notice, very, 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 very important. 5 marks, so many times they have given. So what is exactly special notice? A special notice is given, generally ordinary notice is given by a member. But a special notice is given, sorry, ordinary notice is given by the company. Normal notice under 101 is given by company to everybody. But a special notice is given by such members, which members? Who have 1% voting power in the company. 1% voting power in the company or 5 lakh paid up share capital. Such member or members will give special notice to the company, not earlier than 3 months before the company and not less than 14 days before the meeting. Not earlier than 3 months before the meeting, not less than 14 days before the meeting. Company will forthwith give to all members, not less than 7 days before the meeting. That's what it is. Not earlier than 3 months, not less than 14 days. Company will give to all members, not less than 7 days before the meeting. Very simple. The special notice can be sent only and only in 4 cases. First, removal of director before expiry of his term. Appointment of new director in place of director who is removed at the same meeting. Both speak about removal of director before expiry of the term. Removal of director before expiry of his term. That is point number one. Next, third and fourth, appointment of auditor other than retiring auditor. Expressly providing that retiring auditor shall not be reappointed. This is removal of auditor on or after expiry of the term. 140 subsection 4 is what? Appointment of auditor other than retiring auditor. One more is what? Expressly providing that the retiring auditor shall not be reappointed. This is not removal of auditor before expiry of the term, because removal of auditor before expiry of the term is given under 140 subsection 1. This does not require a special notice. This will again come in my chapter number 10. Appointment of auditor other than retiring auditor, expressly providing that retiring auditor shall not be reappointed. This is called removal of auditor or replacement of auditor on or after expiry of the term. Special notice is not needed for removal of auditor before expiry, and it is not needed for removal of director on expiry. It is only needed for removal of director before expiry of his term and removal of auditor on or after expiry of his term. That's what it is. Resolution is to be passed at the adjourned meeting. Whatever resolution I pass at adjourned meeting will be taken as if it's passed at the adjourned meeting itself, on the day on which it is passed and not on the day of the original meeting. Such resolution shall not be deemed to have been passed on an earlier date. That is very, very simple. Filing of resolutions. Anything under special resolution, that is all we need to know, will have to go through MGT 14. All resolutions here will go to MGT 14 within 30 days. Resolution altering AOA, special resolution, any board resolution for appointment or reappointment of managing director, all these things will go under which section? MGT 14 within 30 days is what they say. Minutes of the general meeting, minutes of the meeting, again very important, shall be signed and kept. The minutes of the meeting of proceedings of every general meeting, every meeting class of shareholders, every meeting of class of creditors, meetings of the board of directors and all that. They will ask you who should sign. It should be signed within 30 days of the conclusion of the meeting or passing of the resolution, and the discretion of the chairman. This is also important. Minutes of the meeting should contain only those things that transpired during the meeting. In the meeting, if some irrelevant things they are discussing how come RCB is winning matches, they are discussing how come it is raining a lot today, then they start fighting with each other, personal attack. Can all those also, should it be included? No. At the discretion of the chairman, he may feel if anything which is irrelevant, anything which is immaterial, anything which is detrimental, that is against the interests of the company, anything that is defamatory, that is going against the person, defamatory, defaming, putting a black mark on him, then the chairman can remove those points. It is totally at his discretion. Chairman can exercise absolute discretion to the inclusion or non-inclusion of the minutes. It will be recorded. Distinct minutes should be kept for AGM, creditors meeting, board meeting, and any other committee. Committee like audit committee and all those things. Who will sign? Each page of every minute book shall be signed, initialed or signed on the last page by the chairman of the meeting, of the same meeting or the next one, and all these things. Minutes of the general meeting will be signed by chairman within 30 days. In case of his death, one more fellow authorized. Resolution passed by the postal ballot will be signed by chairman or any other director authorized. Now, minutes book will be kept for how long? Permanently. Will be kept permanently. Again, that is an important part. Permanently it will be kept. Punishment if you do not have the minutes, penalty of 25,000 rupees. Every company should pay. Officer in default should pay 5,000 rupees. If you are tampering with the minutes, means you are creating minutes today, then any person, imprisonment section 2 years. And non-compoundable offense. Dangerous. Right? Then, can I inspect the minutes book? Yes, sir. During business hours, any member can do. Or what all? Can I take copies also? Yes. Any general meeting available to any member within 7 days. Soft copy will be free. Hard copy will be maximum 10 rupees per page. That's the thing. If you don't do that, penalty will be levied. then the entire AGM, I have to send, a listed public company has to send a report. Report will be in MGT 15. And report should have a fair summary of all the things that happened in the AGM, business transacted and everything. This report also should be signed by the chairman or his inability to sign, other person authorized. But two directors of the company to whom one of them shall be managing director and by the company secretary. So basically it will be the chairman plus CS or MD plus director plus CS. Chairman plus CS, MD plus director plus CS. As far as OPC is concerned, everything with respect to the GM or board minutes etc. In a one person company, you cannot meet others, you'll be meeting yourself. So resolution, if it is entered in the minutes book, that is deemed to be resolution passed. That is deemed to be resolution passed. With this buddies, we have completed chapter number 7. So that's all, very very simple. So now what we are going to do tomorrow, today that is enough. Tomorrow we are going to finish chapter 8, chapter 9, chapter 10. And tomorrow's discussion is very important because chapter 8, 9, 10 will come both in law as well as auditing. That is exactly why it is extremely important. So we will meet tomorrow. I hope you understood everything. Tomorrow we will meet for most important chapters 8, 9, 10. On that note, let us end today's class. I had fun. Hope you had fun too. Take care, buddies. Bye. See you. Ciao. See you.